And now for the Black Firehouse Podcast, the only Ghostbusters podcast that discusses props, costumes, sets, and special effects, with your hosts, Austin Young and Dan Harshman.
What is that thing you're doing?
It's technical. It's one of our little toys.
The proton pack is not a toy.
I guess it's right.
Hey, everybody. This is Dan Harshman, and this is our inaugural first episode of the Black Firehouse Podcast. I have my good buddy Austin Young here. Austin, say hi.
Hello.
How are you today, bud?
I'm doing pretty good. I'm psyched and I'm ready to do this.
I'm very, very excited. So, yeah, this is the first episode of the Black Firehouse Podcast. This is the first podcast that either Austin or I have ever run. I've been a guest a few times on a couple others. How about you? Have you run a podcast yet, Austin?
Absolutely not. So I have no idea what I'm doing.
Well, luckily, I guess I'm driving it since I'm the one with the Riverside program over here.
Totally okay with me.
So let's start off with just kind of introducing ourselves, letting our super limited all three listeners, which is you, me, and like one other person. It's going to be Dan Aykroyd. He's our only other listener. Yeah, this will get them to buy our vodka. Let's introduce ourselves a little bit. Austin, tell me a little bit about yourself. I mean, I know you, but you know,
okay. First of all, we have to address an issue. My name is Austin Young, but most people on the internet nowadays know me as Ray Cameron. So just to clear up some confusion, if you see Ray Cameron posting, that is me. I won't get into the long of it, but
it's your witness protection.
It's my witness protection. I decided to ditch Facebook as like a social thing altogether and just use it for Facebook groups and shit. So, but I wanted to use an alias cause I don't want my family members to like send me friend requests and shit. Like, cause I just don't care. So, but, yeah, like, I guess I'll start with like my history with Ghostbusters, which started like literally my first memory. My earliest memory is I had to have been 2 or 3 years old sitting on my grandma's floor in her living room watching Ghostbusters on TV. I don't know if it was, you know, a VHS tape or HBO or what, but the main thing I remember is the very end of the movie. When they're pulling Lewis out of the terror dog, and you know, Lewis is like, oh, the superintendent's gonna be pissed. And I remember leaping to my feet and running into the kitchen where my mom and my grandma were like making dinner or whatever, and running in there and going, the superintendent's gonna be pissed, and then running right back into the living room and finishing the movie. So that's where it started, and that's where it's like it hasn't ended ever since. I was a Ghostbuster my first Halloween that I dressed up, and I've pretty much been a Ghostbuster ever since. I think I was Batman for a couple of years one time.
I think everybody was Batman at one point. I think I was Batman the year after I was a Ghostbuster.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, you know, like everybody else, I grew up watching the movies. God, hundreds of thousands of times. And, you know, I had all the toys, the tents, the sleeping bags, you know, and right around, I want to say, I had a Star Wars phase. It's not really a phase. It was like a separate part of my fandom existence, but I kind of shifted over to Star Wars for a while and ended up starting a Star Wars fan club when I was like 13. And one of the people that joined that group was Charles Walker. And if you remember Charles Walker, he went by Prop Fan.
Yeah.
since been banned, but whatever. We're not going to get into that. but, you know, he joined and he was talking to me and, you know, saying that he built these replica movie props and stuff. And, like, I'd always liked to build stuff when I was a kid. And he told me that, you know, he did Star Wars props, but that he also did Ghostbusters stuff. And I was just like, oh my God, people build Ghostbusters props. And I immediately, like, got on the internet, and that's where I found, you know, Ghostbusters prop archive, Ghostbusters homepage, all that good stuff. A site about props, ASAP. And yeah, ever since then, that was like 2001. And I've just been in it ever since, man.
That's awesome. Yeah, I mean, yeah, you and I guess, probably got into the online community within 3 years of each other. But we're roughly the same age. So our experiences, neither one of us got to see Ghostbusters in theaters when it premiered. And we were both little guys when Ghostbusters 2 came out in 89. But very similar to you, I was introduced to Ghostbusters actually at my babysitter's through the cartoon. And
nice.
And after I could identify the toys on the shelves, my mom decided when I was about 3 years old that I was old enough to see Ghostbusters. And I never repeated, you know, the superintendent's going to be pissed, but I do have very strong recollections of hiding under the blanket whenever Zool was floating over the bed, because the part in which she, you know, that jump scare part where she reaches out to Peter always scared the shit out of me when I was a little guy.
Hey, the jump scare in Afterlife when Callie kind of lunges toward podcast. I've seen the movie like 20 times now at this point. It still gets me every time.
yeah, I've only seen it 4, so I guess you got me outmatched on there.
We know how obsessive I am. It's
what?
Just,
no, this isn't a podcast for obsessive people. This is a very casual thing. We're not going to be.
Yes.
That's a lie. We're doing all kinds of deep dives.
In fact, only listen to this if you haven't seen Ghostbusters.
Yeah, because the entire thing will make complete sense. Yes. So yeah, 97 rolled around and we got the internet at my house. And, you know, back then you didn't really have search engines. You plugged in whatever website, and I plugged in Ghostbusters.com and ended up on Bill Imko's Ghostbusters homepage and lied about my age and signed up back in 97. So I was like, yeah, I remember you have to be 13 years or older to join this. So I was like, I was 10. I was just like, nah, I'm breaking the law. And close enough. I mean, it was pretty much right around the corner. And yeah, just from there, I mean, always been obsessed. You know, my favorite stuff was always Christmas. Of course, yeah, you know, other geeky things, Star Wars, Lord of the Rings, Men in Black, all that's back there. But Ghostbusters has always been that primary love. And then getting into the online community, and that culminated actually for you and I in 2009 with the first PKE surge, Dragon Con.
Yeah.
You were part of the planning staff for the first 2 years, weren't you?
That's what I'm told. I honestly don't remember. I remember being involved. I don't really remember what I did, other than I think I got like the t-shirts printed and that kind of stuff.
You got t-shirts, you got pins printed. Yeah, you helped at the fan table. We had a lot of, you did Ghostbusters TV.
Yes, that's true.
And yeah. That was a lot of fun. I loved Ghostbusters TV. That was a great project.
Eventually, we're going to bring it back. There were plans to bring it back this year, and, you know, pandemic and a new Ghostbusters movie coming out and all that stuff kind of sidetracked it again.
Plans to bring it out this year, 3 years ago. See, that's the true Ghostbusters spirit. That start filming this spring, right?
It's been greenlit. We're production number JQ73-2119. And yes, we will be rolling cameras in the spring. You're not going to believe this new equipment we've got. Oh, it's out of this world.
And Let's see. So yeah, now I'm president of my own Ghostbusters franchise that became 501c3 this year. That was exciting. And running Spengler's 1984 workbench, which is the official discussion group, I should say, for the Black Firehouse podcast. So I got those linked up today. So if you like the podcast, or if you like the forum and want to hear that more deep dive, attention to detail, kind of obsessive compulsive research or Ghostbuster stuff, definitely check out Spengler's 1984 workbench on Facebook.com. Any other cool projects that you've been working on there, Austin, before we move on? All right.
Always
that
a million
was great.
In the planning stages.
No. Planning stages. We'll tell you, you know what? That this is a perfect segue. We're going to go into our next segment because this is a podcast about Ghostbusters props, costumes, sets, and special effects. We're going to go into another next segment here called our workbench segment, what we're working on. So we'll go ahead and get that going now.
There's something very important I forgot to tell you.
What?
I collect spores, molds, and fungus.
Why?
So, Austin, what are you currently prop-wise working on?
I have a couple of afterlife builds going on right now, proton packs. I'm refurbishing the one that I built a year and a half ago.
Well, you were one of the first people to come out of the gate with an afterlife build. How much has the now deluge of information that we've gotten, how much has it changed compared to what you already understood about the afterlife, specifically the Phoebe proton pack?
It's actually really surprising that, you know, once I finished mine, I sat on it for a while I didn't make any changes to it because, you know, I knew everything there was to know about it that from the information that was available at the time, and was just kind of waiting for the movie to come out. But prior to the movie coming out, you know, released all those amazing pictures of one of the hero packs, and you know, seeing the pack that I built compared to those, it's crazy how close it was just from the limited information. And I'm not trying to brag on myself. I'm just like, I blew myself out of the water with that. I was like, what are the odds, you know, that it would be this crazy close? And so it's just been a matter of minor tweaks. I wanted to redo the paint job on it a little bit. You know, upgrade a few things, a couple of pieces, like the, you know, there was the rumor going around for a long time that it utilized a Dixie hook instead of a machined V hook. But, you know, we could confirm that the one on the bottom of the thrower was in fact a Dixie hook, but we couldn't tell from the available reference at the time what was on the pack itself.
It's a strange V hook that they put on the pack. It's almost traditional, but it has that big ugly weld on the bottom.
Yeah.
And I wasn't sure why they did that. If it was just because it still has the two attachment points that the Ghostbuster mm-hmm. 1 V hooks had. I didn't know if that was maybe a structural choice or just a quick choice. I was a little confused by that.
Yeah. And you know, it's little things like that, like mysteries that I like to solve. Like, was that a practical, solution for a problem? Maybe it was always coming loose or something, or is that an aesthetic choice to kind of play into the, you know, haphazard repairs and the band-aids that have been put all over the thing to just keep the thing running, you know?
Absolutely. I think one of the coolest things, you know, that you mentioned, that was it part of the actual aesthetic design or if it was a functional thing. I think one of the things they did on the V-hook that was definitely a functional thing was that the rearmost bolt on the V-hook on the wand actually has like a nut on there, like a spacer that jets
like
out
a
little
stop.
Bit. Yeah, so that the wand actually ends up sitting higher one is cradled mm-hmm. and is then theoretically easier to get to, which is something I guess they maybe had done for Grace McKenna since she was so small compared to the pack. I know one of the things they had a little micro switch on the back handle on the front because she couldn't, her hands couldn't physically reach the trigger mechanism on the trigger box.
Well, and you know, there's the shot in the film in the field where she goes to take the wand off and like it catches and it sticks and she's got to try a couple of times to get it off. And I love that because how many times has that happened to us?
A lot.
It's such a little detail, but it, oh my God, for people like us, it just, oh, it sells it so well.
I think she had a lot of fun with the props. I think she had a lot more fun with the props than say the original Ghostbusters. Cause for her, she was always a Ghostbusters fan. I mean, there's, you know, pictures of her floating around in a Ruby's Ghostbusters Halloween costume. I think like 2 or 3 years before she even got the part.
Yeah.
So it was kind of cool. It was easy to as a fan put yourself in her place or in podcast's place in the movie, which was cool.
Absolutely. And I mean, you know, if you were 12 years old and you got to run around on the set of a Ghostbusters movie and play with real proton packs and traps, I mean, you'd have a field day.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. So right now I have two projects that I can say that I'm more actively working on than the others, which is my wife's proton pack. I actually for Christmas got her a 80% scale Ben of Kent proton pack kit, and I've been slowly working on that. It's a nice little kit. The shell itself is a polyurethane resin casting. I'm still not sure if I'm going to glass the back of it. It seems pretty sturdy enough on its, you know, size, on how big it is. The lines are really crisp, very, very similar to what I would expect Ben's, you know, 100% scale proton pack is. And then I'm working on an IDW pack out of a old ABS shell that, who did I buy that shell from in 2011?
You probably bought it from Ryan McKinley.
No, I bought it from you. But you got it made from Ryan McKinley. I bought it from you.
It was a project that Ryan and I worked on together. And yeah. Half the time he sold them, half the time I sold them. I don't remember.
They're good shells. They stand up. I mean, you know, there's always things that you could improve, especially looking back on something from 10 years ago. But
yeah, they were cool for the time. You know,
a lot better than the Studio Creations at the time. I'll say Studio Creations really has come a far way on their vacuum form shells.
Yeah. I still, you know, when we did those shells, I was adamant that, no, we've got to leave all the cosmetic ribbing off because, you know, when you do a vacuum form pull, that detail is going to be so soft, it's not going to look right. But then we put the cyclotron rings on, and I still don't understand that decision, but whatever.
Yeah, I'm frustrated with that decision because I have to take them off. For the Sorry. Fact that I'm doing, it's okay. I mean, it's all right. The entire time I'm cutting him out and refilling and everything, I'll curse your name, but
that's fine.
It's a fun project. It's interesting interpreting all of Dan Schoening's artwork into an actual physical prop and seeing what he drew. You know, of course, there's going to be inconsistencies. It would be like building something from the real Ghostbusters. There's going to be inconsistencies with the animation. There's inconsistencies with Dan's artwork. But there's still a lot of fundamental, like, regular aspects that he puts in there, even outside of, like, the dual HGAs and stuff. Just little details that I've been noticing pouring through the comic books and, you know, getting my reference material for it. And finally got a custom designed gun box from Shapeforge Props. You know, I kind of sent him in a list of must haves for the gun box, and he did it up for me, and then ordered a few more parts from Send Cut Send, which is a great resource if you just need some simple aluminum stuff. And it's coming together. I'm really excited about it. I'm really excited about it.
I'm excited to see it. Like, you know, the few progress pictures you posted, just the, like, extending the gun mount and the crank generator and all that. It's like, it's such a simple thing, but it already is taking shape, you know?
Yeah, I haven't shared any pictures yet of the big piece I got from Send, which is if we were using standard proton pack terminology, it'd be their equivalent of the gun ears, but it's more like a whole block, like a barricade between the end of the barrel and the rest of the wand front, and it came out really, really awesome, and I'm excited to get that, you know, bolted in and everything.
Nice.
And it's really cool. It's a really cool wand design. It's just different enough. You know, it's kind of like the Afterlife props. It's different enough that it makes it interesting and new and exciting to pour over, but it's familiar enough that, you know, you're still getting your fanboy, oh, that's that part. Oh, cool. They still kept that, you know, those kinds of aspects to it. So it's definitely been a fun project going on.
Like, going back to what you were saying about, you know, the inconsistencies and stuff, like, that's something that I actually really enjoy seeing. You know, people tackle and seeing people's different interpretations of the reference material because of those inconsistencies.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen some really creative takes on, you know, aspects of the real Ghostbusters packs and things like that. And so to see, you know, you tackle one of these, because as far as I'm aware, you're the first person to tackle one, aren't you?
Well, yeah, but now that I've put it out there, I'm sure somebody else will beat me to the punch.
Yeah, probably, but, you know. We're on the record here right now. You're the first person to start one.
Yeah.
Maybe not the first to finish, but the first
person to put all the superhero information in one place, and now there's like four of them that have been built before mine. I'm just like, ah, that's what I get for wanting to share all my research.
Hey, but also an upside to that I've learned is that a lot of times, some of the frustrations you go through trying to achieve some of that stuff, other people go through by beating you to the punch, and then you can learn from them, and it's way easier on you.
only when they post their frustrations. Otherwise, it's all personal and hypothetical.
That's true, but yeah, I don't know. I'm excited to see your IDW pack. I am too.
I'm at the point now where I'm finding that my box cutter tools are not sharp enough to cut through the styrene that I have, and I've like gotten new blades. And even those, the styrene is just tough enough, just thick enough that I have to make like something like 20 passes over the plastic just to do the ribs, which is really, really frustrating. But once that's done, it'll be all about, you know, kind of putting them in place, clamping them down, taking a heat gun to him to warp them into the shape of the shell. I think the biggest thing I wish I could do with that shell is I wish I had a massive sand belt so that I could get the entire underside even. Because when you guys pulled them, when you pulled the bucks, they're just a little uneven everywhere. Now, luckily, because it's, you know, ABS with a fiberglass backing to it, there's still a lot of pliability. So, like, once it's attached to the motherboard and bolted in, you won't be able to notice. But working on it, man, that hits my want for everything to be plumb.
Yeah,
it's not doing it.
Unfortunately, that was also kind of the downside of wanting to do the shell as one pull rather than, you know, several chunks like most people had been doing at the time, is, you know, we couldn't do it on our little homemade vacuum form machine. So we ended up having to have one of our local plastic supply places that does fabrication and things, you know, undertake that whole thing. And there's a little bit of trial and error with them because, you know, they're used to pulling large pieces, but not necessarily pieces that are that deep or with that many different levels and of thickness and peaks and valleys and things. And so we actually had to create some additional pieces for them when they pull them that you know, not only is it pulling the plastic over the buck, but then we had to create some cutouts and some chunks that they could put on top of the pool while it was being, you know, while the air is being sucked out, to try and force that plastic down in some of those crevices and stuff. And, you know, it's not a perfect process. So a lot of them ended up just shallow of the, what would be the cut line.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it is what it is. And at the time it worked.
It's one of those, you know, looking back at something like that, you got to remember, man, what'd you guys make the original bucks in? Was it 2010 or 2009?
Oh, it was like 2006.
Jeez. I mean, 2000,
you know, cause,
but even if you built them in 2006, coming up into 2011, they were still the best vacuum form shells available at the time.
Yeah. I mean, and we just did them for ourselves to start with. You know, a group of us were like, hey, we want to build proton packs. And, you know, we looked at the materials and we didn't want to do them out of wood. And there wasn't really anybody doing, you know, quality fiberglass shells at the time, that I recall. I mean, certainly not on any kind of regular offering. And
I think fiberglass shells didn't really start becoming a thing until 2008, 2009.
Yeah. So, yeah, we just decided, okay, well, let's build a buck and we'll vacuum form them. And, you know, our naive thought process was, well, they'll be lighter. And really, once you fiberglass it and reinforce it and get all the shit on it, it's damn near just as heavy as a fiberglass shell.
Yeah, I think the only successful, hey, this proton pack is lighter, is that really, really fantastic foam pack, the tutorial that went on YouTube recently, where the pack is something like 4 pounds, which is just incredible to me.
Yeah. Or even like Fingergy that did the foam packs for Afterlife. I think they said those packs weigh like 8 pounds.
That's awesome. I want a foam pack.
I want one too. That's one of the, you know, thousands of projects on the never ending to do list is like, I want to build one of those foam packs.
Well, that'll be the great part about this segment. So I'm only going to talk about two projects that are on my workbench. I'm going to ignore the other ones that are also there. That way it'll seem like I have more projects when they're all just sitting there gathering cobwebs while I wait for the weather to change or wait for parts to come in. It's definitely interesting. What are we talking about tonight?
I believe we're talking about uniforms, at least Ghostbusters 1 uniforms.
Yeah,
I'm sure
we'll
tackle GB2 at some point.
We'll get there. So we're doing Ghostbusters 1 uniforms, and let's go ahead and get into that.
You know, it's just occurred to me, we really haven't had a completely successful test of this equipment.
I blame myself.
So do I.
Well, no sense worrying about it now. Let's get ready. Switch me on.
Right. So obviously the whole purpose behind the Black Firehouse podcast is talking about Ghostbusters props, costumes, sets, special effects, and doing deep dives on that. So today we're not starting on proton packs. I thought that'd be the obvious way to start, but there's a lot of really exciting things happening right now in regards to Ghostbusters uniforms, and seeing as you can wear a proton pack, and unless you're doing a courtroom scene, people, you know, even then they might not really understand what you're doing. But if you have a flight suit on with that Ghostbusters badge on your arm, people pretty much always know exactly what you're about. So today we're gonna start by talking about the Ghostbusters 1 uniform. Austin, what was your first uniform? Did you do a Ghostbusters 1 or did you start with Ghostbusters 2?
It was the Ghostbusters 1. You know, luckily for me, my dad had known a guy, still knows, the guy that runs pretty much the main military surplus store in our state. Like, there's like four of them in the whole state. And, you know, at least the one in the Oklahoma City area. So, you know, I was lucky enough, I was able to start out with a Nomex, like right off the bat, right?
Nice.
And I remember, I wish I could remember the exact year that I started putting the uniform together. It had to be 2001, 2002. Because I did it before I even started trying to tackle a pack. But the, you know, the patch I bought was some like giant, it was like an oversized, I think the No Ghost logo was like 4 inches around. And it was some like fully embroidered like eBay patch or whatever. And of course I ironed it on, you know. And the name tag and the elbow pads I had actually bought from, there was a guy back in the day that went by Dr. Stance. I don't remember his real name, but he used to sell Ghostbusters uniforms and like uniform components. And I bought the elbow pads off of him. Like they came already like spray painted gray, and he did these custom embroidered name tags. So I got one with my last name on it. The font is totally wrong. The material is totally wrong, but at the time it was awesome and I loved it. And I still have the uniform, I still have the patch. I think I tore the logo patch off and tossed it in the garbage. But I even still have the elbow pads. I still use them like to this day, which is crazy, they've held up that long.
Oh wow.
Yeah,
my first flight suit was, well, not counting the children's costumes, you know, if you go beyond.
Well, yeah.
My grandmother sewed my first jumpsuit together when I was a little guy. And I still have that. Like I still have that jumpsuit that she put together for me.
Yeah, I have the little licensed Ghostbusters 2 jumpsuit.
Awesome.
I still have that. Great... And I ripped the knees out of it when I tried to put it back on when I was like 8.
Yeah, eight, or do you mean like 28?
Oh, well, no, like 20.
My first arm patch was the scifipatch.com No Ghost logo with that just atrocious face and like super
the black border,
heavy black border, and it was way too small, so it looked tiny on your arm. And I didn't even have a name tape. I think at one point I printed out a name tape. Like I found a Ghostbusters font online and printed it out and put like tape and put it on my chest. And it looked great in photos, but up close it was just like, man, this is hot garbage.
I used to force my little cousin to dress up as a Ghostbuster with me. And that's what I did for his name tape, is I printed one out and just like scotch taped it, or packing taped it to the spare flight suit that I had.
So where should we start? Jumpsuits or patches?
Let's start with patches.
You want to start with patches?
Let's save the uniform for the last.
Who makes the best patches right now? Your opinion. Go.
It's so... The problem is it's so relative depending on the individual and what you're specifically looking for. But, you know, talking with you and doing the research and stuff, as far as a GB1 patch goes, it's got to be the Todd Cook.
Absolutely.
And just in terms of, you know, the overall design and the materials, construction, but even like the size, at least the size, you know, compared to a screen used Stance patch.
So... I had a really interesting conversation with Todd Cook. The guy really knows Ghostbuster patches. And he put a lot of interesting kind of thoughts into my head and things that he talked about. And one of the things you had brought up is it depends on who you're looking at. And one of the interesting things that he had mentioned to me is that, you know, these weren't hand done patches. They were machine done, you know, but they were done in 1983, so the machines were still limited, so they end up having kind of a handmade quality to them, but they were still machine processed. And part of his evidence for that is the thumb on the No Ghost logo, you know, the aberration that, mm-hmm. you know, the detail nuts are really all about, which is where it looks like they started to embroider the thumb and then got halfway through it and said, nah, this is ridiculous. Yeah. And then there's the actual back material, which again has gone through a few evolutions, and which at one point it was thought that it was felt, but it's more of a kind of a fuzzy moleskin. Yeah. And apparently it's a fairly hard material to track down. But Todd was bringing me through it to the point that he actually is currently postulating that the Ghostbusters 2, the brownstone scene, the arm badges that are on the Ghostbusters 2 uniforms are actually ripped off of the Ghostbusters 1 uniforms, which is why the Venkman uniform didn't have the same No Ghost patch on there anymore, or why it was moved, because they actually removed it off of one of the Ghostbusters 1 jumpsuits to use it in Ghostbusters 2, which, man, the more I look at his designs and looking at screen grabs, I'm seeing it. And the more that I'm looking at the overall design work, I think it's the Calgary Ghostbusters who are offering the character variations. And yeah. looking at them and talking with Todd, I'm wondering, are we actually seeing different patches, or are we seeing the same patch that we can only get certain angles on? And because we're looking at it at different angles, we're seeing what we're believing to be different characteristics, but in reality, all the arm badges are actually the same. Now, one of the things I would definitely recommend for our listeners there, when we're referencing things here, we're really looking a lot at, I'm going to give a shout out here to the Ghostbusters Reference Library on Facebook, which was run by a really awesome guy named Stuart Thompson. He has basically scoured the internet and picked off every single piece of Ghostbusters reference material that is available and has put it together in literally thousands of photos, all organized into different albums. And so today we're mostly looking at the Ghostbusters uniform album. He started this project in, I would say, spring of 2021, and it's an incredible, incredible resource for our listeners.
I love
there.
It.
I do too.
I'm on it multiple times a day, like every
constantly.
Day.
Constantly. Constantly. Well, and there's so many photos that like I already have that sit on my phone or sit on my computer, but what ends up happening is I'll photo dump onto my computer, or I'll, you know, transfer stuff to a hard drive or something like that. But it's so cool to be able to have one spot where you can go and it's all there. I know.
Yeah.
GB Fans was at one point really in the front lead for that, but man, Stuart has just knocked it out of the park, and he's constantly updating it. Anytime there's new material that comes out, anytime that something new is found, and everything on the Ghostbusters Reference Library is also publicly accessible and editable. So if people have something that hasn't been seen on there, they're able to upload it into those albums, which is great. So it ends up being this massive community library of just incredible, incredible, you know, photos.
Yeah. And I know he's requested it in the past, you know, for anybody listening that may contribute to it. If you do contribute something to it, you know, make sure you reach out to him and, you know, get his contact information so you can actually send him the full resolution images. Because Facebook, unfortunately, that is the only downside, is Facebook kills the resolution.
Yes. And so, he keeps everything on a Google Docs drive that yeah. I believe is available upon request if you ask him for it.
I think so, yeah.
Now he's going to get all the messages. Poor guy. Sorry, Stuart.
Yeah. We'll edit this out later if he doesn't like it.
No, we won't.
Okay. we have to say it though, just to play nice.
Yeah, to play nice. There we go. So yeah, you know, those were the things that Todd was saying, is that, you know, we're not seeing really different patches. We're seeing one patch machine created, but 1983 technology. So there was still limitations. There's still roughness to it. And that all the Ghostbusters essentially have the same patch, which was really, really fascinating to me. And even more so fascinating when he was talking about them being reused in Ghostbusters 2, because I always thought, well, they probably just made new ones, but, you know, studios end up cutting corners on really weird things. And that would be one of the weird things that they might have cut a corner on.
Yeah. And, you know, it's, I'm glad that you brought that Ghostbusters 2 scene up, because that's something I've wondered for years is, you know, they have, it's the herringbone suits. It's the Ghostbusters 2 name tapes, but it's the GB1 logo. And, you know, like you, I always assumed, yeah, they just cranked out a couple of GB1s and slapped them on there. And it's one of those things that's always been in the back of my head. Oh, I need to go through the movie and go back and look at that and research that. And I've just never done it. So it's nice to know somebody else is out there doing that work, you know, for the two people that would ever want to do that variant of the uniform, both of which are running this podcast right now.
already planned on doing that. I think you and I did Nomex versions of the epilogue suits in like 2010, in which we had Ghostbusters 2 name tapes and Ghostbusters 1 logos, and 100% of people did not even notice, much less give a shit, except for you and I are like, oh yeah, it's my epilogue suit.
And that's also one of those moments where you want somebody to come up and be like, that's the wrong name tape for that logo. And you can be like, actually.
I tell you, during Dragon Con last year, I did a jumpsuit based off of Bill Murray's Scream Awards acceptance speech. And he had two Katara 8 No Ghost logos on either shoulder, and with a Ghostbusters 2 style name tape, and you know, the hazard vest and everything. And I did that suit, and I even found the exact same elbow pads that he used. I found them on Amazon, they were still available, and put that suit together, and like two people understood, and it was AJ Quick and Craig Goldberg of Yes Has Some podcast and GB fans respectively. And even though it was only two people that got it, it totally filled my heart with such incredible joy when I think Craig or AJ came up to me during the awards dinner and they're like, hey, I just got what you're doing right now. And I was just like, yes, thank you.
Dude, when you texted me, you know, hey, guess what I'm doing? And then you just sent me that picture of Bill Murray. I was like, oh, fuck, yes. Like, that is that crazy, esoteric, just strange shit that I love.
It's the Ted and Annette Fleming cosplay.
Yes, 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 yes. I love that. And, yeah, being able to be, like, meticulously accurate with the elbow pads and the patches and everything just warms my heart, dude.
And finding the same kind of seatbelt that he was using, because it's not a pistol belt. It's just a, you know, airline class seatbelt material belt that he's rocking. And then, like, the fact that I was pouring over screen captures from the Scream Awards to figure out my Bill Murray jumpsuit.
And the best part is that's probably not the weirdest thing you've done for a Ghostbusters prop, you know?
No, probably not. Probably not, but we'll get into that. So Todd Cook, yeah, definitely top of the line. If you are able to get one of his V3 and patches, I mean, like, so talking with Todd about it, He says that the material, the base material, the background material on it is relatively hard to find. And I'm going to take his word on it because, I mean, he brought me to school about the No Ghost logo. He says he can't find any more. So if you are able to get one of the V3 patches, definitely cherish it. Because apparently it's not going to be widely released. However, his other patches are great. He did two other versions. It's all coming out of the same designs, but his V2 patch, it doesn't have the thumb aberration, and it uses a felt material. instead of the moleskin material, and it's still just a fantastic patch. I mean, it's just phenomenal. I mean, one of the biggest things that a lot of the people get wrong on their screen accurate patches is the prohibition sign. And it's a byproduct of what current embroidery machines do. So they don't really expect you to want that big, ugly, bubbly 80s look. So it ends up either being 100% embroidered, or you end up with weird lines and stuff through them. But his just come out perfectly. And from what he tells me is it's because everything for his patches are now in-house. So he's not sourcing them out. He's got his own machine that he was able to calibrate and able to get that prohibition weight correct. They are absolutely gorgeous. I'm definitely using his V3 for my Ghostbusters 1 suit, and I'm going to use his V2 on a Ghostbusters 2 suit once I come around to ordering that. But I mean, there's really still some awesome offerings out there. I know you have the Calgary guys have a very, very accurate Ghostbusters Afterlife no ghost patch.
Yeah, and you know, the Calgary patches are great. I mean,
they are.
You know, I've got a couple of them. I think I've got one of the Venkmans, and I think it's a Stance. I can't remember, and I don't have them handy to look at. But I mean, they're beautiful patches. They're well made.
They are.
You know, and they look fantastic. And the fact, you know, that they're so similar to the Afterlife patches now. I mean, you know, it's nice to have that resource for people that are wanting to do highly accurate Afterlife stuff. You know, because they're nothing against those patches at all. They're fantastic patches. It's just,
no, they're phenomenal.
You know, when you get to people like us that are just so anal retentive about the smallest, littlest thing, you know, of course.
Well, Calgary, man, if you want to talk about where they knocked it out of the park, I gotta hand it to their name tapes. Holy shit, dude, their name tapes are screen accurate wise just perfect. I mean, it's this really thin, very pliable fabric, but like the letters on them, just they're wonky enough. They just come out great. And but still, if you know, if you're looking for something that's not necessarily giving into that screen wonk, GB fans, 100%.
Absolutely. Well, and that's something else, you know, that there's varying levels of, you know, accuracy, and I'm air quoting here. Some people want an idealized accurate, right? They want the shape of the letters, but they don't necessarily want the wonky asymmetry of the letters, the not so neat embroidery. And that's totally valid, and I 100% get that, you know.
Oh yeah.
I like the shitty wonky, you know,
it name depends tapes. On what I'm doing. So yeah. I mean, I have my wife hates it. I have probably about 15 jumpsuits at this point.
Yeah.
And depending on what I'm doing with that jumpsuit depends on what name tape I'm going for. When I did the Scream Awards, I went automatically straight to AJ for his no ghost logo and for his name tape. I know the Scream Awards were done by Katara 8, but I wanted AJ's stuff just because of that crisp and perfection, you know, that really, really nice finish that his patches have. And I know AJ has also, interestingly enough, recently offered a amalgamation screen accurate patch. I use the idea of screen accurate very loosely because it's an amalgamation of the wonkiness of all four patches and what design elements him and I forget, forgive me, who he was working on with them. But they essentially chose what parts they liked best about each of the four available examples and put it together. The only downside, I think, with the patch is the prohibition, is it still doesn't have that that 1983, 1984 kind of bubbleness to it. But I mean, AJ's using state-of-the-art machines, but it's still so cool. So like, if you want something that fits that mold, but you still want to be your own Ghostbuster, you can still have that wonky patch that doesn't belong to any of them, which I think was a really cool idea.
Yeah. I really like that patch. I don't actually own one yet. I've been meaning to pick up several for exactly that reason. Like just, you know, my personal jumpsuits that I want to do, you know, having something that's a little, just a little bit cleaner, but still has that touch of wonk that is charming about the original patches.
Well, I know I have plans for a video game jumpsuit, and no question, hands down, I'd go to AJ for the name tape.
Yeah.
Because the video game's not going to have any wonk to it.
No.
And that's one of the things I think people need to understand, especially about this podcast. And of course, this is going to be something that I'll say many, many times, is that accuracy and quality are not necessarily the same thing. Something can be an incredibly quality product and not necessarily be screen accurate. And something can be screen accurate and really be a gigantic piece of shit.
Exactly. Yeah, I agree. 100%.
And so, yeah, so patches, definitely, as far as Ghostbusters 1 style, if you're looking for something idealized, I would go to Ghostbuster fans. If you're looking for an afterlife patch, I would definitely go to Calgary and Todd Cook for the hyper accuracy nut on those arm patches.
Do you know when he's supposed to put out his V3, when they're going to be available?
So from what I've heard, it's supposed to be this month. So I would I would keep a super close eye on his Facebook page. He has Todd Cook Designs on Facebook, and I would keep a very, very close eye on that to see when he releases them. He was kind enough to send me a sample, and it's outrageous. I mean, it's just gorgeous. Like, it's one of those things where it's like you get to that level of accuracy where I'm like, man, I could just go and tear off one of the screen used patches and put this in its place, and nobody would know except for me. And then I could go to sleep happy knowing that I have a stolen screen used patch.
Now, we don't want to anyway.
But if you can't get his V3, his V2s, man, they're still incredible. But his V3s, they're even off-white. I keep going back to them. I'm gushing over it. It's such an awesome patch.
I can't wait to get them. Like, as soon as you had shown me the pictures of the sample, I was like, oh yeah, I gotta have, like, at least four of these things.
Oh, good luck getting one. if you get four... I'm limiting myself to one on that, but
I mean, I'm not gonna be. I want at least one, and if I can't get one, then I'll probably just kill myself because there's no point in living anymore.
Wow,
that's not true.
Wow, I'm not that. So this will be a solo podcast.
No, it's not gonna be a solo podcast. Nobody even liked that movie except me.
I liked it.
Oh, thank you.
I mean, it. I had the same problems with it that I had with Ghostbusters Afterlife, but that's not for this podcast.
No. Moving on.
So those are patches. How about the jumpsuit? Where do you get your jumpsuits? What kind of jumpsuits do you get?
Oh, well, like I said previously, my dad's really good friends with the guy that runs the local surplus store. And so I've always used Nomex suits. I think the only time I've ever used anything else was when I did a GB2 charcoal. You know, I did the true spec and stripped it and redyed it. But even my first attempt at a Ghostbusters 2 charcoal suit, I used a Nomex olive drab suit and dyed the shit out of it. It did. That's the thing.
How?
I don't know. I've never been able to replicate it. I still have that suit somewhere. I'll have to pull it out and take some pictures of it.
You really should. So one of the things is Nomex is not a brand. Well, it's a brand, but it's a brand of fire retardant application. So when you're looking at military grade flight suits, which is the closest thing, of course, is the CWU-27P coveralls, which is the standard military issue flight suit. And 100% none of the films used them.
No.
Straight across the board, they were all made either by in-house wardrobe or other companies. For Ghostbusters 1, they were made by in-studio wardrobe. And man, I searched for years and years and years and years trying to find a better than the Nomex style flight suits. And I came really close twice. Once, amazingly enough, was a Rothko. And if you can find, they're really hard to find, Rothkos from the late 90s, they are incredibly close. They have the right stitch count, and they have metal zippers, but they're not brass zippers, mind you, and they also don't have the storm flap over the pen pocket on the arm. So they're closer than any other jumpsuits, but they used to be really, really excellent. And then I guess they changed manufacturers sometime in the early noughts, and now they are garbage. I mean, just, you know, they have that weird yellow tinge to the dye lots now. Plastic zippers, the breast pockets hang out by your navel for some reason. They're just, they're not good choices. And for like our bigger listeners or people who are just getting into it, because the Nomexes only go up to 52 long.
Yeah.
You know,
which even those are really hard to get a hold of, especially now since they stopped using the one piece and they've gone over to two piece.
So if you need something bigger, go with TruSpec. TruSpec definitely has the larger sizes. The only downside now with TruSpec is that they don't have any of the lower pockets. I think they have the side access pockets, but there's nothing on the legs like in the screen used ones. So there's no knife pocket on the inner thigh, map pocket, or survival radio pocket on the legs.
Yeah. I know that's a genuine that is a version of a genuine military suit, because I've got several navy ones and olive drab ones that lack all of those pockets too. In fact, the navy ones are Flight Suits Limited or Gibson and Barnes, and I think the olive drab ones are probably Carter Industries.
Interesting.
And that's something I've always meant to look into, is like, is it, you know, what kind of variation of the suit is that? Is it a dress uniform of some sort?
No, it wouldn't be a dress uniform, but it, you know, I wouldn't count out other militaries as well. I know in my research, the CW-27Ps are also really close to the K2 uniforms, which are also then very, very close to the just after Vietnam era lightweight coveralls. And there's a lot of like similarities between the designs, but then there's ultimately things that don't match up. You know, for a while I was under the impression, well, were the Ghostbusters 1 jumpsuits, were they actually off the rack? And after searching, it's not even a rare variation of the jumpsuit at this point. It is, they don't exist.
Yeah, they never existed. There's too many things. I mean, I've done that research too. I've gone back and looked at, you know, vintage flight suits from all eras, and there's just nothing that comes close to matching.
Well, then there's the big thing, which is they were two-tone, which the military is not going to do that.
Yeah. And you know, that's such a weird thing about those uniforms.
Well, what's weird is the capturing of it. So dyed or undyed, Austin?
Not dyed.
Not dyed. I would agree.
Now, I don't believe these suits, once completed and sewn together, were then dyed.
Okay. I think that's a fair assessment. I don't think before they were sewn together, they were dyed. I think it is two different dye lots.
Yeah.
But I think it's specifically tube fabrics that came in those particular shades of khaki, one being very, very khaki. And you can look at, again, Ghostbusters reference library there, looking at the Spengler jumpsuit and then also the Stance and Venkman jumpsuits. These are the screen used uniforms. These are the hero uniforms. So how about, why do people think they're gray? Why do people think they're over-dyed gray?
I mean, I don't know if I want to get into this. You know, there's an individual. I'm not going to name names.
Not even, no, even getting away from that.
Yeah.
Everybody seems to hang on to the Casey Kasem throwaway line.
Yeah.
The boys in gray. When he says the boys in grace in his very thick accent. And yeah, it does sound like the boys in gray. But one of the interesting things is that line was recorded with Casey Kasem not having seen the movie and was done, I think, a month before the movie actually hit theaters.
Okay.
I don't know. Did you think he said the boys in gray?
This is one area where I'm not going to fight you, but I don't necessarily agree. I don't hear that at all. I hear the boys in gray.
I hear boys in grace. It's going to be that, what is it from Who Framed Roger Rabbit? What is Daffy Duck and Donald Duck actually saying to each other?
Oh yeah. 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 No, even, you know, discounting that line, just the fact, I mean, they look gray in the movie. They absolutely look gray in many
parts of it.
But that's also gray is such a relative term. Like, there's so many shades of brown and khaki, like they all contain some sort of gray in them. And I don't believe for a second the intended color was gray. I don't believe that they were supposed to be represented as gray in the movie. I think that's just a byproduct of the film stock and the lighting and you know, the fact that khaki can absolutely look gray in the right kind of lighting.
Well, it could take on so many shades. I mean, you light them with green, it's going to look green.
Yeah, and I mean, if you want to get into the real nerdy headcanon kind of shit, like in my mind, if you are logically thinking of it like in universe terms, they're not getting their uniforms custom fabricated. They're going and buying military surplus. As far as I'm aware,
you don't think Janine was in the basement with the containment unit in a big tub of hot water dying? Dying no. Suits gray?
No. I mean, I know that there have been some actual gray flight suits, and I believe there's some Vietnam era ones, aren't there?
No, it's olive drab. They're olive drab that have faded out. Yeah, I've seen those before, and they do. They end up looking very, very gray-ish, but it's olive drab that has faded out considerably.
Well, I mean, and that makes sense. I mean, there's, I don't know how many times I've gone on eBay looking up flight suits, and you know, I see olive drab listings, but I mean, like, well, that looks gray in that picture. That looks gray, you know. But even going back to that, like, let's say they're using off the rack military stuff, like in the universe canon, they're, you know, why would they? You would think logically they're going to go with something that existed, which would be a khaki flight suit.
Yeah. Yeah. You know? And that's exactly what existed, were khaki flight suits.
You know, I think a lot of times, and I'm guilty of this, you're guilty of this, everybody's guilty of it, but sometimes people make it more complicated than it needs to be, or in reality really is.
Yeah.
You know, as far as the, you know, going back to the two-tone, nature of the suits, once those pictures kind of started to surface of those suits where the two-tone was like really apparent, because from my recollection, that's kind of a fairly recent discovery. within the last decade?
Last 5 years, I think it really came to light when the Venkman jumpsuit went up on the auction block. And it was interesting because now, though, you can go back and look at screenshots and what would have been interpreted as maybe shadows at the time. You can see, even in the film, they were two-tone.
And that's such a crazy like thing that, you know, stuff has been staring us in the face for years and we've just never realized it. But, you know, going back to when those pictures came out and it became apparent, okay, these are two-tone, and it's a drastic difference in color. There's no way that, you know, these panels faded and aged differently than these panels. I mean, there could be a little bit of that, but not to the degree that they are now. And which tells me it's intentional. They were intentionally structured to be two-tone this way. I don't believe the intention is for them to be two-tone. My theory is that they located the ripstop fabric. They got sent however many bolts of fabric, and there's two different shades, and they made it work. They knew if they intentionally pieced these suits together in a two-tone fashion, it's probably not going to get picked up on camera. But even the two-tone, it's not consistent with every suit. There's a couple of suits where I can't remember off the top of my head, but one of the arms is very clearly the khaki fabric, whereas on some of the other suits, it's the gray fabric, or vice versa, something like that.
Right.
So, yeah, I think it just boils down to it's just two different batches of fabric with two different dye baths, you know? Like,
I would tend to agree with you. I'm looking again at these photos, and there's some shots of a Venkman jumpsuit, and one of the Venkman jumpsuits, you know, it all looks straight khaki. And then there's other shots. I'm not sure if it's the same jumpsuit or if it's a different one.
Yeah.
I mean, the actors obviously had multiple jumpsuits.
Yeah.
And then, of course, you had brought up an interesting theory about the overdye, which is stunt actors.
Mm-hmm.
In which did the stunt actors have off-the-shelf uniforms? And unfortunately, then that becomes an item of trying to locate good screen reference of when it is definitely a stunt actor wearing a suit.
And I've gone through some of my pictures the other day that I had of their publicity stills, but they are, you know, publicity stills of the scene right when the ground breaks open and they fall in, and it's right before they've fallen in, and it's the stunt actors with the stunt foam packs. And yeah, I don't have anything of any high enough quality to be able to determine anything. You know, they look like scans out of an old magazine or something, you know, like they're really grainy and pretty small.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't done a deep dive looking for higher resolution versions of those pictures yet, but it's on the list of things to do eventually.
I know one of the best photos, I would say, is probably with Harold Ramis standing next to his stunt double. And the suit is relatively darker than what Harold Ramis is wearing. And they're both in equal light. And I can't see really clear enough to make the judgment call. Yeah. But from what I can see, I'm not seeing the side access pockets, and I'm not seeing the same hallmarks on the cuffs. So one of the big things that definitely indicates that they're not off the shelf is those side access pockets. Those are not really on the 27P jumpsuits. They don't have side access pockets. They don't have side pockets. And then the cuffs themselves actually link very flush with the end of the cuff. You know, you have that cuff adjustment, whereas the ones in the movie are actually about half an inch to an inch off of the cuff.
Yeah.
And looking at this, unfortunately, too blurry to really, really tell.
Yeah.
but I know his stunt double, the cuff is hemmed right there, which, I mean, that could be it. That you know, the stunt ones could be those off-the-shelf suits. That's definitely a possibility.
Yeah, but then it goes back to our discussion, you know, earlier. We've never found off-the-rack suits that match.
Right.
So it's a weird thing. Like, and if you look at that same photo, like, Tom Morga's belt is considerably lighter than Harold Ramis's, you know.
Now, unless, of course, the stunt doubles, we would need more information. But if they are off the rack, then they wouldn't necessarily be ripstop like the actors.
Yeah, and see, that's, you know, and this is all going under the assumption that, you know, as far as budget goes, they're going to budget for your principal actors to have custom garments made,
right?
But not for the stunts. You know, things are different now, obviously, like with Afterlife, like all of those flight suits are fabricated, stunt actors, stand-ins, heroes. But in 84, on the shoestring budget they had, I don't see them fabricating custom suits for stunt actors, but, you know, who knows?
They might have, yeah. It's very definitely difficult to tell with what reference we have available to us. And whereas hero suits have come to light and have hit the market and we've been able to document, we don't have any confirmed stunt suits that have hit the market, which is unfortunate.
You know, if the stunt suits, let's say they were off the rack or something, or I mean, even if they were custom made, potentially, the stunt suits may have had the patches ripped off and gone back into a wardrobe rental or something like that, you know, and they've disappeared, and who the hell knows where they are at this point.
Yeah. So that's our deep dive on Ghostbusters 1. Who have you gotten a chance to check out the Magnolia Ghostbusters 1 jumpsuits?
I haven't seen one in person yet. I've seen lots of pictures.
They're nice.
Yeah. I want to get one. I have plans to get at least 2, maybe 3 of the GB1 suits at some point. I definitely want one of the GB2 herringbones, one of the GB2 charcoal, but I definitely want one of those ripstop suits.
They're nice. They fit. So I got one. I got one and I sent in my custom measurements. And even with my custom measurements, it did come in maybe half a size to a size smaller, which is okay. I need encouragement to lose some weight. But definitely something for people to plan on if they're buying one of them. Has really spot on brass zippers. The fabric sits great. And one of the things I love about it is when I was looking at it and taking photos of it or putting it in different places, I had it hanging on a door frame for the longest time, just admiring it, is it accurately will change color from being very much khaki to very gray, and that I got to tell you, that pleased me to the core to kind of see that in person. The patches it comes with are not great. Anybody that is spending that much money on a custom flight suit, I would definitely not have the patches already sewn on. I would definitely go to other vendors for the name tapes and the arm badge. But the flight suit itself, it's quality made, has side pockets, not side access, which is also accurate to the movie, which is really, really cool. Has all the appropriate pockets, the knife pocket, no weather flap on the pen pocket on the arm. The breast pockets are at the right height. It's really they did a great job. I'll hand it to them. I'll also say buyer beware. I know a lot of people have also had problems with Magnolia, whether it be the sizing just being completely wrong. I heard one guy, the suit came sewn inside out, which is crazy.
Yeah. And you know, the thing, and I've heard people, you know, have had a bad experience or not a great experience, but honestly, from what I've seen, it seems like the majority of people have been pretty happy with them, you know, minor things aside. I know personally, I haven't seen anything that would probably make me hesitate to order at all. Like, you know, aside from it showing up inside out, you know, and the thing too is, I think I read something a couple of weeks ago that I guess supposedly they are doing away with standard sizing and they will only let you provide custom measurements.
That's my understanding as well, which I would, if you are providing custom measurements, I would maybe add an inch or two to those custom.
Yeah. And I think some issue may be, and I don't know this for sure, but like people are saying it's too small. Well, you know, you have to, most people wear these on top of clothes.
Yeah.
So you need to definitely accommodate for your clothing and then add some buffer there because, you know, if it's better to be too big than too small. And you know, just from seeing the films, you can, you know, the flight suits themselves are not form fitting, you know, they're baggy, they're loose, and that's the look I want to go for. So
yeah
I would absolutely.
So wearing a flight suit when you're in the military, you want it to be form fitting because you gotta fit in a cockpit.
Yeah.
As a Ghostbuster, you want it to be loose. You want it to be baggy and airy and you know, that's definitely the look that I would go for as well. Right now, I'm not doing the baggy look so well.
me either. Like in my prime, I was wearing like a 42 or a 44.
Yeah.
And I think I'm wearing a 48 right now.
I'm at 50, like, bud. So you gotta
do that. See, that's the thing.
Punch up those numbers.
The 48. It's not snug, but it's just shy of being snug. And I was like,
you're just shy of looking like a sausage.
Yeah. If I could find a 50, I would absolutely. But like getting those bigger sizes, like even finding a 48 was pretty tough.
I lucked in and found a number of 50 regulars for like $30 a piece. So I bought all of them. I just have spare jumpsuits. I have jumpsuits over jumpsuits. I'll get another one in and my wife will be like, why are you ordering another jumpsuit? It's like, well, I have an idea for a variant.
Yeah. Dude, I just sold off a bunch of jumpsuits because, you know, I mean, I already had God knows how many, but, you know, the friend of my dad's that owns the surplus store, because the military has switched over to these two-piece suits, they're not selling their one-piece suits as much anymore.
Right.
And so my dad calls me one day and is like, hey, Mark just gave me a bunch of flight suits. And I was like, oh, cool. How many? He's like, there's like three boxes.
Oh, my gosh.
Dude, there was like 36 khaki jumpsuits and like 10 olive drab and a couple of like the olive drab mechanic coveralls and some other random stuff. And I was just like, holy shit. And of course, none of them are big enough to fit me right now, but
right now
there was a lot of smaller ones, which are also good to hang on to, especially if you've got, you know, kids or women that, you know, want to utilize a real Nomex suit. Those are nice to have on hand. But
so
yeah, like
if you had to put, I know how I would, if I had to put, you know, what I would want to buy as far as accuracy goes in order, it would be at the top of the list, Magnoli. Then it would be a military surplus Nomex suit. And as you said, they're Carter Industries. I've also seen them by Eagle Industries, Proper, Gibson and Barnes, those brands. After that would be a True Spec. And then there's nothing else.
Yeah.
No Rothko. That doesn't exist.
I would probably agree the Magnolia is at the top of the list. And then if you could find an older Gibson and Barnes or a Flight Suits Limited, like a suit that was made when they were still Flight Suit Limited, like even if you're going for GB1, even though that pattern is accurate to Ghostbusters 2, I would still utilize one of those for a Ghostbusters 1 jumpsuit. I've got one And the color is really nice.
There was also Cockpit USA about 7 or 8 years ago. They had a, they called it their 60s vintage flight suit, and it was ripstop, and it was actually pretty accurate, but apparently they sold so few of them that they stopped making them altogether just as I had enough money to get one, unfortunately. And I don't even know where you would begin to find one of those.
Yeah. I mean, good luck.
Yeah.
So yeah, I would go, Magnolia, Gibson and Barnes, Flight Suits Limited. And then, yeah, any Carter Industries, Nomex, CPU or CPW, True Spec. And I guess there's an Amazon jumpsuit now. There's some kind of jumpsuit that people have been buying on Amazon that looks okay. I think it's better than a Rothko for sure.
Is it Fox Industries? Is Fox Industries getting into the jumpsuit business now?
I don't remember. I can't remember. Somebody had made a post on the Spengler group probably a month or so ago, kind of doing a comparison. And I was unaware that that was even a thing, like
an option.
I was surprised. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, it gets to be that thing is like I stop looking at anything less than a military surplus just because you know they're going to all be virtually the same and they're all going to virtually be precisely where you need them to be. You know, I'm happy to get four jumpsuits from Magnolia. You know, I have my khaki ripstop, I have a charcoal, and then I'll get two herringbones from them.
Yeah.
And maybe one more ripstop to do an afterlife suit with. But for all the other stuff, all the experimenting and all the more, I would say, you know, fun jumpsuits, the whatever jumpsuits, the franchise branded jumpsuit, I'm just going to default over to Nomex because the consistency is there. I always know what product I'm going to get. And while brand new, they're going to run in the realm of, you know, $100 to $200, used, you can get them for like $30 or $40, which is the same cost as a True Spec or a Rothko. But
yeah,
the quality's higher. You just have to do a little bit of eBay hunting and it's not that bad.
Well, and two, something else we should probably mention is there's two different weights to those Nomex suits. There's a standard weight and there's a summer weight.
Yes.
And the summer weight, by far, if you can find them, they're usually a lot rarer, but they are so much more breathable. They're so much they're so much nicer, and the coloring on them is actually a lot closer to the Ghostbusters 1 suits.
Right.
They have a little more of a gray tinge to them, whereas some of the other ones tend to have almost kind of a pink hue to them. Mm-hmm. A little bit, but you know, if you can score one of those, and it'll say it on the tag, you know, it'll say somewhere summer weight
or flight suit summers, you know, something like that.
Yeah.
Well, listen, we are coming up on an hour and a half, so we've definitely gone over what we would normally
exactly
or are hoping to do for our podcast. But I think we're going to go ahead and wrap it up for tonight. How do you feel about that?
I'm cool with that. We can do a part two later covering elbow pads and belts and boots. And
yeah.
All that
so we'll, next episode, then we'll talk about boots, elbow pads, and, belts for the Ghostbusters 1, costume. So, if you want to talk about super accurate Ghostbusters props and costumes and effects, of course, please feel free to join us on Spengler's 1984 Workbench on Facebook.com. Give us a like on Instagram, Black Firehouse Podcast. You can also find Black Firehouse Podcast on Facebook. And thank you so much for listening to our first episode. We hope you enjoyed it. We had a lot of fun recording it. You have a lot of fun there, Austin, buddy?
Absolutely. Awesome. I could do this for hours, dude.
Well, we're gonna do it only for an hour and a half as to not get too repetitive. So this is Dan Harshman for Black Firehouse Podcast and Austin
Young, Ray Cameron on Facebook if you really want to get into it.
Thank you so much for listening, guys. Have a great
day. Thanks, everybody.
As a duly designated representative of the city, I order you to cease any and all supernatural activity and return forthwith to your place of origin or to the nearest convenient parallel dimension.
Okay, so I'll see you later, huh? I'll give you a call.
Two in the box!
Ready to go!
We be fast and
they be slow!
You do? You have?
Well, that wasn't such a charno, was it?
Oh, nice shooting, Tex!